So hi guys, I hope you all can see me live. I'm just waiting for a confirmation that you all can see me live. Okay, great. I can see myself live. Welcome to this session. And this will be a deep conceptual session, and it will be a not a very big session because I try to keep things very, small so that you can learn faster. So in this session, we are going to learn about sarcoidosis. Okay. So when we talk about sarcoidosis, what comes to your mind? What comes to your mind when we talk about sarcoidosis? Can anyone put it in the comment? What comes to your mind when we talk about sarcoidosis? Now, sarcoidosis is a disease that involves abnormal collection of inflammatory cells. So there is a collection of inflammatory cells, and these inflammatory cells form lumps, and these lumps are called as granulomas. So sarcoidosis is nothing but formulation of granulomas throughout your body. Is this clear? So first thing you have to remember, what is sarcoidosis? So when we talk about sarcoidosis, it is a disease where abnormally inflammatory cells accumulate. We will see how does those inflammatory cells accumulate and what do they do. But we have to remember, it is nothing but an abnormal accumulation of inflammatory cells. And these inflammatory cells form lumps, which are called as granulomas. Now, the first thing you will know, already you might have been knowing, that there are two different types of granuloma which we keep studying, caseating and non-caseating. When we talk about sarcoidosis, it's essentially non-caseating granulomas. Can anyone put me right in the comment, one or two causes of non-caseating granulomas apart from sarcoidosis? So we know sarcoidosis is a very important cause of non-caseating granulomas. Can anyone write in the comment another one or two cause of non-caseating granulomas? Remember, the two inflammatory bowel disease, okay, especially the ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease, both of these also present as non-caseating granulomas. A quick revision, if anyone can tell me, what are the causes of caseating granulomas? What are the causes of caseating granulomas? There are three important causes. Number one, very important, tuberculosis. Number two, histoplasmosis. And number three, cryptococcus. So these are the three important: tuberculosis, histoplasmosis, and cryptococcus. So these are the three important causes of caseating granulomas. So again, causes of caseating granulomas, causes of non-caseating granulomas, very important for your PG entrance examination. Before we look into the pathophysiology, let me talk about some of the very favorite questions, very favorite one-liners which have been asked in this topic. Okay, the first is, what is the most common organ which is involved in sarcoidosis? Can anyone comment? Can anyone comment? Which is, hi Ram, Ramdev Yadav, कोई बता सकता है कि कौन सा most common organ involved है sarcoidosis में? Anyone can comment. So this is a very favorite question which they are going to ask you. Remember, the most common question, organ which is involved in sarcoidosis is lung. And sometimes when they have given this question, they have not given lung as an option. So the second most common organ which is involved is skin. So these two organs are very commonly involved in your sarcoidosis. The most common organ which is involved in is lung, and the second most common is skin. So sometimes when the lung is not in the option, you can use skin. Another question they keep asking is, which is the least common organ which is involved? So the least common organ which is involved is the cardiac tissue. Heart is the least common organ involved. Okay. Then in one of the examination, they have asked, what is the most common cause of death in a sarcoidosis patient? So remember, the most common cause of death in a sarcoidosis patient, because lung is involved, is respiratory failure. The second most common cause of death is angioinvasive mycetoma. What happens when we are going to see the complete picture of sarcoidosis, we will see that there is a lymphopenia. And when we use steroids for treatment, there can be further fall in lymphocytes. So we know that when the lymphocyte level falls down, the patient will be more prone for angioinvasive mycetoma, something very similar to what we saw in COVID patients. We used high dose steroids for management of COVID, and then what happened? Because of that instance of fungal infection increased. So something very similar we are going to see. So remember, the most common cause is respiratory failure, because lung is one of the most common organ which is involved. The second most common is angioinvasive mycetoma. There was a question in which they asked, not the most common cause, but mark my word, they asked, what is the most common cause of sudden death? So it was not just they asked, what is the most common cause of death? The most common cause of sudden death. Now, for then the answer will become cardiac tissue. So arrhythmias are the most common cause of sudden death in these patients. So again, these three questions were asked. And remember, even though it's a complete systemic disorder, 50% of the cases will have a spontaneous remission. I hope all of you are clear till now. So what is sarcoidosis? Sarcoidosis is basically, you know, a disease where abnormal collection of inflammatory cells happen, and these inflammatory cells generally form lumps, okay, called as granulomas. In case of sarcoidosis, it's a non-caseating granulomas. Another two causes where non-caseative granulomas are there is your ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. We should also know the causes of caseating granulomas, which is the most common organ involved, which is the second most common organ involved, which is the least common organ involved, what is the most common cause of death in these patients. So all these questions have been asked in this examination. So moving forward, let's look at the etiopathogenesis. Now there are two, you know, bacteria which are involved in etiopathogenesis of sarcoidosis. One is Propionibacterium acnes, which is, you know, responsible for the acne. And there's a specific M. tuberculosis. There's a specific antigen called as MCAT antigen. MCAT G antigen we are going to see. So these two are the bacteria which are involved in sarcoidosis. Remember, it's not an infective disorder. It's a inflammatory disorder. We are going to see why it is an inflammatory disorder. So how does it happen? Basically, you know, a specific MTB catalase peroxidase oxidase positive, you know, so catalase peroxidase positive M tuberculosis, they have this antigen, MCAT G antigen. Now these antigens, we know what will happen. These antigens will be taken by antigen presenting cells, and these antigen presenting cells will further lead to increase in CD4 count. And what will happen once the CD4 count increases? There will be a production of interferon, gamma interferon, and interleukin-2. We know that interferon, gamma interferon is involved in formation of granulomas, and interleukin-2 further increases the CD4 count. So this is the pathogenesis of sarcoidosis. So there are some specific antigens which stimulate the CD4 cells, which further produces gamma interferon, interleukin-2. This gamma interferon is involved in the pathogenesis of your granuloma formation, and interleukin-2 further, you know, makes the CD4 count increase. So it's a vicious cycle. This happens. So hope all of you are clear about the pathogenesis of sarcoidosis. Now there are two important pathology based question which is asked on this point, and there are two specific, you know, bodies which are found in, you know, when you are going to see. So what happens is, if you see, so this is like the giant cells. Okay, we know these are inflammatory cells, macrophages. Okay, and outside this will be your CD4 cells. Okay, so this is how a particular granuloma will look like. Okay, now there are certain inclusions, both intracytoplasmic. Okay, there are certain inclusions, so we can see there are certain inclusions which are inside the cell. Okay, and they have, you know, star like shape, so they are called as asteroid bodies. Okay, and there are certain inclusions which are extracellular. These are called as Schwann bodies. So both these bodies have been asked in the examination. So if it's an intracellular inclusion, you can see an eosinophilic star like inclusion. This is called as asteroid bodies, typically seen in your sarcoidosis. And then you can see this extracellular exclusion. Okay, you can see this extracellular inclusion, this one. So this is your Schwann bodies. Now if you see, it is distinctly bluish in color. And why it is bluish in color? It is bluish in color because there is a calcium deposit here. So because of the calcification of this deposit, it takes a bluish stain. So these two are very important pathology based question which they are frequently asked. Where is asteroid bodies found in which disease? Schwann body found in which disease? You know, which is intracytoplasmic, which is extracytoplasmic? All these questions have been very frequently asked. Okay, now let's look at how the patient will present to you. Now if the patient is presenting late, okay, so typically you can have an age of presentation somewhere between 30 to 40 years, even earlier presentation can be seen. And, you know, cough, dyspnea on exertion, even dyspnea on rest and stridor, these are the symptoms which the patient will present to you. In fact, if you take a proper history of these patients, this patient may be visiting doctor for a very long time. And they will, you know, so even though they will have this cough, dyspnea on exertion, dyspnea on rest, stridor, these symptoms, pretty, you know, that is the time when you are going to look for some very specific cause. But if you see, these patients will have very commonly, they will be coming with very vague complaint. Doc sahab, I'm having very fatigue. Even if I sleep, I'm not feeling very fresh. And this is what they will be, you know, if you take a history of 4 or 5 years, this is what they will present with. So fatigue, lack of energy, weight loss, joint ache, something which we do not give a lot of importance when we are, you know, seeing, because many patients will come like that. Okay. So this is the initial presentation, you know, before the actual symptoms develop, he may complain of vague fatigue, lack of energy, weight loss. Even if he is sleeping, he is not very fresh. Okay. And then some symptoms which start, you know, making some sense, like dry eyes. He will start complaining of dry eyes. Okay. Swelling of knees, even blurry vision. We are going to see all these things. Okay. So this is how the patient progresses from very non-specific symptom. And slowly when he's like really presenting to you with cough, dyspnea on exertion, stridor and dyspnea on rest. Now remember, when we talk about dyspnea on rest or dyspnea on exertion, okay, we generally think of cardiac causes. So how do you differentiate that this is, you know, not a cardiac cause? The main thing, you know, clinically will be when we are going to see this sarcoidosis, it is a multi-system. They are going to be skin manifestations. We have told that skin is the second most common organ to be involved. But when we talk about cardiac cases, again, there will not be any skin manifestation. Another thing, these patients can also complain of night sweats and weight loss. And many of these patients are actually put on ATT. Okay, because of their non-specific symptoms, when you many times you will not have EA. So night sweats and weight loss again. So it is very essential to differentiate from tuberculosis. Again, very simple, tuberculosis will not have any skin manifestations primarily. Okay, and here you will have a system. We are going to see what are the different, you know, clinical features in different symptom. But remember, tuberculosis will not have skin symptoms. But these patients, if you examine properly, they will have skin symptoms. They will have a lot of different unrelated symptoms which you can put together. So cough, dyspnea on exertion, a very important point about stridor. Why does a stridor present? Now, we are going to see the first thing that will happen is hilar lymphadenopathy. So hilar lymphs will become big. And what they will do is they will start impinging on the airways. And that will lead to stridor. So this is again a very, very, you know, late presentation. So stridor. About cough, there's a typical, you know, you will find when they talk about cough, they will say that even with antitussives, this cough is not responding. A very classical thing that you are giving, you know, you are keep giving, these patients will have hacking cough, you know, very constant cough. You are giving a lot of different antitussives, but still their cough is not controlled. So all this is the initial presenting features. So as I have told you, it's a multi-systemic disorder. So rather than looking all differently, let us look at system-wise how they will present. So first, let me talk about the CNS symptom. So three important: optic neuritis, lymphocytic meningitis, and central diabetes insipidus. So these are the three important CNS. Now, I know that when I talk about optic neuritis, what is the first disease that will come to your mind? When in a clinical case, if they mention optic neuritis, what is the first thing you are going to think? You are going to think of multiple sclerosis, right? Very good. You are going to think of multiple sclerosis, right? But how do you differentiate multiple sclerosis from this? Now remember, multiple sclerosis primarily CNS symptom, but this is a completely different ballgame. You are going to see there will be ocular symptoms, there will be, you know, skin manifestations, lots of different systems will be involved. So this is very important. So obviously optic neuritis with all the other symptoms, sarcoidosis. Only optic neuritis, you will think of multiple sclerosis. So in examination, these points are very important for you to make a proper, you know, understanding of the case. Okay. So that is one thing. Again, posterior pituitary, if the granulomas form in the posterior pituitary, you can have diabetes insipidus, sometime late manifestation in terms of lymphocytic meningitis. So these are the three things which you are going to get in CNS. Let's look at ocular. When we talk about eye, again, optic neuritis will be there, uveitis and paraplanitis. So these are the three, you know, features when you are going to talk about sarcoidosis, ocular symptoms, optic neuritis, uveitis and paraplanitis. Now, important thing here is a very frequent question, you know, they are going to again ask on the ocular only. Uveitis is very, very important. So when we talk about causes of uveitis, remember, you know, sarcoidosis is a very important cause of uveitis. Is this clear? So this is CNS, ocular. Let's quickly move. And now let's look at what we are going to see on the face. So again, bilateral parotid enlargement. Granulomas can form in the parotid gland, you know, in your maxillary gland. And that can lead to bilateral parotid enlargement. Eventually, this will lead to your seventh nerve palsy. Okay. there can be destruction of these, you know, tear glands and all. So this can lead to Sicca syndrome. So again, this drying of eyes, drying of mouth, again, those kind of symptoms, that is why they are present. Now here, two to three things, they are very important from exam point of view. Remember, when we generally talk about facial nerve palsy, we generally talk of unilateral palsy. There are only few conditions which cause bilateral facial nerve palsy. Sarcoidosis is one of them. In fact, after this, I'm going to enlist all the important cause of bilateral facial nerve palsy. But remember, here, seventh nerve palsy, okay? Bilateral facial nerve palsy or bilateral seventh nerve palsy, sarcoidosis is a very important cause, okay? So, a very favorite question which is asked is, which is the most common cranial nerve to be involved? Which is the most common cranial nerve to be involved? The answer will be seventh nerve. The second question, what are the cranial nerves which are involved in the sarcoidosis? So, remember seventh and second cranial nerve, optic neuritis. So, these are the two cranial nerves which are involved in your sarcoidosis. Once we have learned about the face, as I have told you, let's quickly enlist the causes of bilateral facial nerve palsy. So first important cause is Guillain-Barré syndrome. Don't forget this. This is a very, very important point, super important from your exam point of view. Bilateral facial nerve palsy, Guillain-Barré syndrome. Second is bilateral bulbar or pseudobulbar palsy. Third can be a bilateral Bell's palsy, bilateral parotid infiltrate, for example, in Mikulic syndrome. As I have told you, bilateral facial muscle weakness in diseases like myasthenia gravis or myopathy, then sarcoidosis, and there is a very important infective disease which is asked in the examination. A very important infective disease which can cause bilateral facial nerve palsy, and that is your Lyme's disease. So these are the seven most important causes of your bilateral facial nerve palsy. Let's quickly move to the next system. The next system is your respiratory system. Okay, the most common organ involved, and the first thing that will happen in the respiratory system is your bilateral hilar lymph node enlargement, which will lead to the dyspnea. This will explain the stridor, all those things. This will, you know, explain the cough, all these things. Then obviously there can be fibrosis, and a very characteristic feature of this fibrosis is upper lobe fibrosis. There are three important causes of upper lobe fibrosis which you have to remember from exam point of view. Number one is your tuberculosis, very important. Number two is your sarcoidosis, okay, which we are studying. And the third is ankylosing spondylitis. So these are the three important causes of, you know, upper lobe fibrosis. And third, you can see there can be XL calcification of lung. Now again, XL calcification, primarily, can you tell me XL calcification, which disease generally, you know, what is the characteristic disease which you associate with XL calcification? Remember, it is characteristic of silicosis. But again, it's an occupational disorder. You will have a very different history. But in an X-ray, if you don't have any history and you can see an X-ray, XL calcification, I'm going to show you some X-rays also of some patients. Okay, then you can think of sarcoidosis. So this is the first, you know, the patient is relatively early. And in this X-ray, you can primarily see only, you know, hilar lymph node. Okay. There is very minimal fibrosis at this stage. You can see, you know, you can see there is hardly any infusion. So this is very early. As we move forward, you can see this XL calcification. This is classically your XL calcification. Can you see? These are XL calcification, primarily in silicosis, but they can be seen in sarcoidosis also. Also, you can see some amount of fibrosis is already starting to set in this patient. Okay. This is when the hilar lymph node is already there, but now we have got some more fibrosis. And primarily, when you see this X-ray, you can see the fibrosis component. And this is a very late patient where there's extensive fibrosis. You can even think of miliary tuberculosis if you are not knowing the history properly. So this is your extensive fibrosis stage. Now, once we have learned it, again, a very important question, which is the most common investigation done. So a very easy investigation is your X-ray. So the most common investigation done in a sarcoidosis patient is your chest X-ray, remember. And chest X-ray helps you to stage the lung involvement. How is lung involvement staged from chest X-ray? So there are four stages according to the lung involvement. So the first stage, as I told you, only hilar lymph node enlargement. As I've told you, the earlier patients will only have hilar lymph node enlargement. Stage 2 is when there is hilar lymph node enlargement and infiltrate along starting. Stage 3, extensive infiltrates are there. And stage 4 is the stage of fibrosis. So these are the four stages. Based on the X-ray, you can easily grade a patient. So stage 1, only hilar lymph node. stage 2, there is lymphadenopathy with fibrosis starting to set up. Stage 3, extensive fibrosis, and stage 4, infiltrate, and stage 4 is your fibrosis. Let's move to the next organ, liver. So in GI, granulomatous hepatomegaly. Again, the granulomas will form in the liver and which will lead to hepatomegaly. Okay, this may be tender also. Okay, the next is cardiac. I told you cardiac tissue is one of the least involved tissue. Okay, and again, when there is a granuloma formation in the cardiac, it can lead to an ischemic heart disease, you know, it can lead to a heart block or even a tachyarrhythmia, or, you know, it can even secondarily cause pulmonary hypertension. Okay, now, pulmonary hypertension in examination, how they will put pulmonary hypertension, they will not talk about pulmonary hypertension. They will use this word loud P2 or decrease diffusion lung capacity. Okay, so these are some of the cardiac manifestation. Remember, it is this tachyarrhythmias or bradyarrhythmias which is the most common cause of sudden death in these patients. The most common cause of death in this patient, respiratory failure. The second most common cause of death in this patient, angioinvasive mycetoma. Okay, but most common cause of sudden death, it is the arrhythmias, either tachyarrhythmias or bradyarrhythmias. So this is about your cardiac manifestation. The last system we are going, second last system is bone marrow. So bone marrow, again, lymphopenia. This is very, very important. When you do a bone marrow or when you do a peripheral smear, there will be significant lymphopenia. Now, when we go for the treatment part, we'll see steroid is one of the mainstay of the treatment. And, you know, if you give steroids, the lymphocytes will further come down. And if the lymphocytes go down, what will happen? Angioinvasive mycetomas. So you are in a fix. The drug which is treating the element is going to cause, you know, complications in the patient. So a very important point. Now, a young doctor, if he gets a patient, he may think of starting getting very aggressive, giving high dose steroid. But here you are going to start the steroid in the lowest possible dose. This is when I'm going to talk you to the treatment. Not only that, we will use a lot of steroid sparing agents. So these are the two things which I'm going to talk about when we talk about the management. But remember, we don't go very aggressive. We don't use very high dose of steroid. We use it at the lowest possible dose, which is possible. And even then, if it is not responding, we add some other agents. But we never increase the dose of steroid. So this is about your lymphopenia. Very, very important point when we talk about the management. The last is your skin manifestation. The first skin manifestation is lupus perineum. Now remember, it looks like a malar rash, okay, malar rash, okay, which you find in SLE. But how it is different, I'll tell you. So first of all, remember it's painless. So it may involve the bridge of the nose, but primarily it is limited to the tip. When we talk about malar rash, it is primarily the bridge. But here it is the tip. The bridge may be involved. And if you see, you know, let me just erase all the A. If you can see here, there is a area sparing here. In malar rash or butterfly rash, there will be no area which will be spared. So again, remember this particular thing. Painless, you know, involving the cheek, the nose, especially the tip of the nose. Very similar to the butterfly rash or the malar rash. But the only thing is there is a sparing and the tip will be more involved. So this is called as lupus pernia. Remember, skin is the second most common organ involved. Again, I have told you. Skin is the second most common organ. The second is your erythema nodosum. Now, this is painless. Erythema nodosum is painful. So, you can see these. You can actually feel these tender nodules. Erythema nodosum. Okay. So, this is erythema nodosum. So, these are the two typical clinical, you know, skin findings. Again, I am showing you some other cases. So, here you can see it looks like a butterfly slash. Don't confuse it in the examination. But you can see there is area of sparing. Okay. Here also you can see the area of sparing. So these are all lupus pernia, not butterfly rash. Okay. This is another case where you can see, you know, erythema nodosum classically. Okay. Now, another very important thing when we talk about erythema nodosum is how do you differentiate from pre-tibial myxedema? In a hyperthyroid patient, now pre-tibial myxedema, many students may confuse with pre-tibial myxedema also. So pre-tibial myxedema, the skin is slightly oranges and you will have all the system, you know, symptoms of hypothyroidism. So remember that. Okay. So clinical history is very, very important when you are differentiating. A very important syndrome which they have asked in the examination is Lofgren syndrome. So Lofgren syndrome is nothing, erythema nodosum, painful and with bilateral hilar limb peritonitis. So how it is different from sarcoidosis? The component of arthritis. So arthritis is very prominent in your Lofgren syndrome. So it is erythema nodosum, painful enlargement with bilateral lymphadenopathy with arthritis. So these are the all the clinical features of your Lofgren syndrome. Lastly, I'll talk about endocrine. So endocrine, you will have granulomas, and the characteristic point about these granulomas are they can form vitamin D3. So there will be a increase in vitamin D synthesis, and this will lead to hypercalcemia. So there is increase in the calcium level in your sarcoidosis patient. Very interesting. What do we give for the treatment of sarcoidosis? We give steroid. So sarcoidosis is an important cause for steroid responsive hypercalcemia. Very, very important. It is one of the important cause for steroid responsive hypercalcemia. Second cause, can you think of any other cause where we give a steroid to manage hypercalcemia? The second is when we have, you know, vitamin D toxicity. So in that case, when there is a vitamin D3 toxicity, we give hydrocortisone. Again, it is an example of steroid responsive hypercalcemia. So these two examples you have to remember: sarcoidosis and vitamin D3 intoxication. Both we give a steroid to manage your toxicity. So this is your clinical features. Now we have a very clear picture how the patient will present. I have told you how the patient's initially very non-specific symptoms, then lung symptoms, then your, you know, skin symptoms, then you can have some CNS manifestations, you can have some cardiac manifestations. So how do we work up this patient? So remember, the most common investigation is x-ray, but it is not the investigation of choice. To make a definitive diagnosis, what do you mean? Because we have to demonstrate granulomas, that also non-caseating granulomas. So you go for a biopsy. So investigation of choice is basically your biopsy. Now there are two ways you can do this biopsy. One is an endobrachial biopsy and one is a transbrachial biopsy. Okay. Now if the parenchyma is primarily involved, then you go for a transbronchial biopsy. Okay. And if there is, you know, on the trachea, there is lymph node which is impinging, then you can go for an endobronchial biopsy. So if parenchyma primarily involved, you will go for a transbronchial biopsy. If, you know, there is big lymph nodes which is impinging on the trachea or the airways, which you can easily access through an endo bronchoscope, then you go for an endobronchial USG guided biopsy. So these are the two ways which you can do. Suppose if biopsy is not possible, if the patient does not, you know, okay, then the second important or the second investigation which can give you a diagnosis is your bronchoalveolar lavage. So what do you find in the bronchoalveolar lavage? Two very, very important finding. First is lymphocytosis, that is increased in the lymphocyte count. Now interestingly, when I was talking about bone marrow, when I was talking about the peripheral smear, I was talking that lymphocytes are decreased. When I'm talking about this lavage, I'm saying that the lymphocytes is increased. So remember this, don't get confused in the examination. So there is a decreased in the lymphocyte in the bone marrow. There is a decrease in the lymphocyte in your, you know, peripheral smear, but there is an increase in the lymphocyte when you do a bronchoalveolar lavage. And the second is the CD4 to CD8 ratio. So CD4 to CD8 ratio is increased. Again, another disease where we talk about CD4 to CD8 ratio is your HIV. Okay. There are two other investigations. One is HRCT and gallium 69 scan. Gallium 69 scan is not done. HRCT, we still do it. So these two, there are some specific signs which you have to know from examination point of view. HRCT is galaxy sign. Let me show you that galaxy sign. So basically, this is how a galaxy looks like. Okay. So this is how a HRCT. So you will have one central granuloma and then smaller peripheral granulomas like your galaxy. One central star system and then smaller peripheral stars. So this is your galaxy sign on HRCT, typically seen in your sarcoidosis. One big granuloma, then smaller scattered granuloma. Gallium 69 scans, there are two signs which you have to know. One is a panda sign, one is a lambda sign. So panda sign is very simple. If you see your maxillary and parotid glands are, you know, having granulomas, so you will have something like a panda face. So that is your panda sign. Okay. So, and when we talk about this lambda sign, it is also called as 1-2-3 sign. So you have got your pre and paratracheal lymph node. When you have your pre and paratracheal lymph node, which is enlarged. So right and left paratracheal and the pretracheal lymph node, all these are enlarged, which you can see in this gallium scan. So this is called your lambda sign. Okay. So two important signs on gallium scan, panda sign and lambda sign. Again, gallium scan we do not do, HRCT we still do. Then I would also go for a PET scan. Why do we go for a PET scan? Because I've told you it is a disease not only limited to lung. You know, there are a lot of extra pulmonary places where it can be found, for example CNS. So you would get a PET scan to get an idea that where all are the granulomas. Again, I have told you, even though heart is one of the least involved organ, but it is one of the most common cause of sudden death. You don't want your patient, you know, the moment you have started going into sudden death because of cardiac granulomas. So you can get for a cardiac MRI also. Okay. The last investigation is going for an ACE level. ACE levels, and remember there are four important diseases where ACE levels are increased. One is sarcoidosis disease, which we are discussing, Gaucher's, leprosy, and TB, especially miliary TB. So these are the four, you know, diseases where your ACE levels can be increased. Again, we don't get an ACE level done. We know it just for an academic purpose, and your DLCO, that carbon monoxide diffusion capacity, will be decreased in such patients. So this is how we work up the patient. So now you have, the patient has come to you, you have done all the diagnosis, you have seen. Now, how do you manage it? So remember, one of the mainstay of treatment is steroids. Okay, steroid is very, very important. But as I have told you, you have lymphopenia and you want to use a steroid. So you are going to use the lowest possible, dose of a steroid. Okay, and you want to use it very low. And there are also some steroid sparing agent which we use. And the typical steroid sparing agent, which means that will decrease the amount of steroid which we need to get the same effect, is hydroxychloroquine. So this is again the one of the treatment in your COVID patients also. So steroid with hydroxychloroquine if the patient is not responding to low dose steroid. Now there are some other agents also which we use for management. One is methotrexate, azathioprine, and infliximab. Okay, so all this forms the management of your sarcoidosis. Okay, infliximab, where it is used has been asked in the examination. So just for that purpose, I'm telling, we have already seen that it is used in sarcoidosis. Okay, then we have also seen that it can be used in your all the inflammatory bowel disease. So it decreases the chances of perforation in your inflammatory bowel disease. And third disease where it can be used is your ankylosing spondylitis. Ankspondy, again, it can be used for management of your ankspondy patient. So infliximab, again, a very important MCQ. All these newer, you know, biologicals are very important MCQs these days from pharma point of view. So this brings us to the end of today's session. You know, thank you so much. I would want, and you know, if you can just put in your names. I know it was not a very interactive session. I just wanted to teach you a topic. I'll try to bring up more MCQs in future sessions. Every day I'm trying, you know, for after a very long time I've come alive. So every day I'm planning to go live at 10:30. Make sure that you are, these sessions are primarily for high yield topics and for MCQ practice. Okay. So can you just put in your name? Anyone who's seeing this session live on YouTube, can you put in your name? Because I'm just reading the YouTube comments. They are my users on Facebook and on LinkedIn who will be seeing this live video. But I just have my YouTube on. Anyone can just put it in their name. I'll be very happy to see their names. So Ramdev Yadav is there. Anyone else wants to put in? Okay. So make sure that you keep writing to me on Telegram or anywhere where you feel, you know, whatever topics you want to be taught. And any other feedback, any other suggestion, I'm just waiting for someone to put in their comment. So thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much for attending this session. And hope you really enjoyed it. This is a very important topic from exam point of view. A lot of clinical questions have come. A lot of one-liners have come from this topic. Okay. So thank you all. Take care.